Good morning. We want to welcome each one of you here this morning to the house of the Lord. So are you glad to be here together?
Amen.
Amen. So we're going to open the service in prayer. So let's just put all of our focus on the Lord who redeemed us this morning. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for this day. I thank you so much for these faithful who have gathered together to glorify you and to honor you today. Lord, we pray that you would send your spirit, that you would be very present with us. Lord, lead us and guide us even in our worship. Lord, that our words, our thoughts, our songs would all be pleasing in your sight. Wash clean, even at the beginning of this service, by the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? He who has clean hands and a pure heart. So we come in faith in the work that was done on Calvary, that we could approach you through the blood of Christ. We thank you for that cleanliness, Lord. We come in faith. We come desiring to hear you speak to us, but most of all, to see you lifted up, glorified, and honored today. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Would you all stand with me? Does everybody have song sheets? Song sheets? Everybody? Unlike a week past, they may not all be in order, so pay attention.
Come, now is the time to worship. Is the time to give your come, just as you are to worship, come, just as you are before your God. Monday, every time we'll confess you are God. Every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. The time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those that they choose you know. You are you are worthy, be afraid. I will follow. I will listen. I will love you all of my days. I will sing to and worship the King. Is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. I will sing to and worship the King. It is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. You're my Prince of Peace. I will live my life for you. You are holy. You are my King. You are worthy. Worthy of praise. Now I will follow. Now I will listen. I will love you all of my days. I will sing to and worship the King. It is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. I will sing to and worship the King. Is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. You're my Prince of Peace. I will live my life for you. You are Lord of Lords. You are King of Kings. You are mighty God, Lord of everything. You're Emmanuel. You're the great I Am. You're the Prince of Peace. Who is the Lamb? You're the living God. You're my saving grace. You will reign forever. You are Ancient of Days. You are Alpha, Omega, beginning and end. You're my Savior, Messiah, Redeemer, and friend. You're my Prince of Peace. I will live my life for you. Prince of Peace, I will live my life for you. You're my Prince of Peace, I will live my life for you. You're the Lord of Lords, you're the King of Kings. You are mighty God, Lord of everything. You're Emmanuel, you're the great I Am. You're the Prince of Peace, who is the Lamb. You're the living God, you're my saving grace. You will reign forever, you are Ancient of Days. You're the Alpha, Omega, beginning and end. You're my Savior, Messiah, Redeemer, and friend. You're my Prince of Peace, I will live my life for you. My Prince of Peace, I will live my life for you. Every everything I once held dear, I count it all as loss. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me to the cross. Everything I once held dear, I count it all as loss. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me to the cross. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me to the cross. To the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you. Oh, lead me to the cross. With my soul. has regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with in part, but the whole is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. Clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trumpet shall sound, and the Lord shall descend. Weave and sow, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well. It is well. Well, with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well. It is well with my soul.
Maybe seated.
Good morning. You could hear everybody singing today.
Yes.
Amen. That's a good thing. So if you will turn with me to Jeremiah chapter 7, and 8. Jeremiah chapter 7 and 8. Before we pray, I'm going to speak to you a little word of introduction. I think sometimes, some weeks, I really try to evade what the Lord wants me to say because there are those in the church that really you hear things as a pastor. There's always that saying, a little bird told me. So the Holy Spirit sort of lets you know that sometimes words are difficult for people. And I do understand that. We have a position here at Faith Harvest, and I will share that with you right now, is that for those who long to be right with God, no word from the Word of God is hard. No word is harsh. Because it comes with love, first of all. It comes with the desire of the Lord that we would be right with him in order that he might express his life through us, because he is a good God. Amen? Amen. He's a good Father. Amen. And so when it comes to messages that have to do with difficult things and with judgment of the Lord and with harsh realities, perhaps, in the Word of God, it's sometimes I will try to keep putting that out of my mind, and I'll make up my mind, Lord, this week I'm going to preach just a message talking about Christ and glorifying Christ. And, you know, I don't want to be guilty of being one of those pastors that preaches to tickling ears. So everyone here, I want you to say with me this morning, we don't have itching ears. We don't have itching ears. So we want to hear the true word of God. Amen. And so when I come to this, actually, I'm aware that we have lost people before in the midst of times when the word was very focused upon some harsh realities of what the Lord was speaking concerning where we are and our times and his call to repentance, his call to repentance. If I start preaching a series on repentance, I can almost promise you that there will be those who will either leave or will stay away for a season, and we see that happen over and over and over again. And so I want to come to you this morning and tell you ahead of time that this message is going to be in three parts. We're going to be in Jeremiah, where he speaks a word of judgment to the people of God in Israel in a time that is very similar to the time in which we are living. We need to hear that word. We need to understand God's principles do not change. We are in the new covenant, and we have the blessing of being in covenant with Jesus Christ, and I will come to that. But God's principles with kingdoms and with kings and with nations does not change. His program does not change. And so we have this that we want to hear first, and then I'm going to bring the middle part of the message. It's going to have to do with an issue that I think every Christian, every human being deals with. And I think that even during this time right now that we're living in, it's an issue. You've heard me preach on it many times. Nevertheless, it's an issue that Christians have great difficulty with. And so we want to understand what the word of the Lord says about this particular issue, and we will come to it in a moment. And then the last part of the message, I want to talk to you about why the prophet Jeremiah's message, why as true as it was for him and for us, he had some limitations placed on him that we don't have. We have something that he did not have, and it's a glorious message. And so we will end with the great hope that we have. And so don't anyone say it was a negative message, because it's going to end on a very positive note. Amen? Amen. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank you My desire this morning, Lord, is that you would just stir a sensitivity within the hearts of your people to understand what you're saying, and Lord, a sensitivity to the issues that we will be looking at this morning. I ask, Lord, that you would strengthen me to bring the word. Help me to speak with clarity, not to waste time going down bunny trails, but Lord, to speak what you have given me, nothing less and nothing more. And we will glorify you and honor you in this, all of this day, Lord. We just bless your name today. In Jesus' name, amen. So I'm going to read a good bit of scripture in this first third of the message. In Jeremiah 7, beginning with verse 1, and I will skip some sections, and I'm just going to comment on some things as we go through it. I ask that you would open your heart to the Lord and enter into this as though you were living in Israel at that time and you were part of the people of God, understanding that the issues that they were dealing with are the same issues that we're dealing with today. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord saying, "Stand in the gate of the Lord's house and proclaim there this word and say," and I'll pause there and say that that first line tells us he's speaking to the people of God in the house of God. He's standing and he is going to proclaim. The Lord is giving him a message, and it's during a time when Israel is being judged because they have not followed the Lord with all of their hearts, and they're going to be carried off by the Babylonians into captivity. God is going to chastise his people. How many of you know that the New Testament tells us today, judgment begins with the house of God? I mentioned a week or two ago, all that's happening in our nation today, we can point fingers and we can say, this is wrong. It is the church that God is after. If the church repents, then God will give the church time. God will protect the church. He will keep the church and perhaps even send blessing again, as he promises in Deuteronomy, upon the land. And so he says, proclaim there this word and say, hear the word of the Lord, all you of Judah. This is the southern kingdom of Israel, who enter in at these gates to worship the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, amend your ways, change your ways and your doings, and I will cause you to dwell in this place. If they would just change their ways, they would not be chastised. They would not be taken off into captivity. The heart of God as a good father is that he speaks to us today and says, if you will hear my voice and if you will listen, understand those here today, those listening on live stream, this not only goes to you. You may say, I don't know. I already am walking in this. That's okay. This message goes out to many beyond that around the world. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, amend your ways and your doings, and I will cause you to dwell in this place. Do not trust in these lying words, saying, some people had been saying, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord are these. In other words, he's saying they're taking pride in the house of God and in the temple and saying, oh, look, this is the temple of the Lord. All of these buildings, this is the temple of the Lord. It's like those today who would say, look at our church, look at our campus, look at the multitude of buildings and all of the programs that we have. But God says there must be the fruit of repentance and obedience in order to be the people of God. For if you thoroughly amend your ways and your doings, if you thoroughly execute judgment between a man and his neighbor, if you do not oppress the stranger, the fatherless, and the widow, and do not shed innocent blood in this place or walk after other gods to your hurt, then I will cause you to dwell in this place in the land that I gave to your fathers forever and ever. Behold, you trust in lying words that cannot profit. Will you steal, murder, commit adultery, swear falsely, burn incense to Baal, and walk after other gods whom you do not know, and then come and stand before me in this house which is called by my name and say, we are delivered to do all these abominations? Beloved, this is, if I put this in modern church language, he is saying, are you really going to abort babies? Are you really going to dabble in the occult and mystical things? Are you really going to walk in impurity and uncleanness? Are you really going to do all of these things during the week and then come and stand before me and say, I'm saved, I'm delivered, so I can continue doing whatever I want because I'm saved? And the answer is, of course not. Has this house, which is called by my name, become a den of thieves in your eyes? In other words, do you even see that you have become a place of merchandise? That you are charging people, you are buying and selling in the house of God. It's become a place of profit. God speaks this to the church today in the United States of America. Do you see that you have made my gospel a thing of profit, that you have charged people that they may hear the word of God, that you peddle the word of God? I have seen it, says the Lord. Turn over to verse 28. He has continued telling them what they should do in return to the Lord. So you shall say to them, this is a nation that does not obey the voice of the Lord their God, nor receive correction. Truth has perished and has been cut off from their mouth. Cut off your hair and cast it away. In other words, a sign of ancient lamenting and repentance. Cut off your hair, dress in sackcloth and ashes, and repent, and take up a lamentation on the desolate heights. For the Lord has rejected and forsaken the generation of his wrath. For the children of Judah have done evil in my sight, says the Lord. They have set their abominations in the house, which is called by my name, to pollute it. And they have built the high places of Tophet. This was the same as I know what I was going to say, and I've said it to myself all morning. You all know the God with the arms that they burned their babies, Molech and Baal, have built the high places of Tophet, which is in the valley of the son of Hinnom, to burn their sons and their daughters in the fire, which I did not command, nor did it come into my heart. Therefore, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when it will no more be called Tophet or the valley of the son of Hinnom, but the valley of slaughter. For they will bury in Tophet until there is no room. The corpses of this people will be food for the birds of the heaven and for the beasts of the earth. And no one will frighten them away. Then I will cause to cease from the cities of Judah and from the streets of Jerusalem the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride, for the land shall be desolate. Now, we are not there, but beloved God, by his hand, you can talk about the men that have done it. You can talk about the reality of a sickness, all that you want. It's truly there. But God is sovereign. Nothing happens apart from his hand, his permission. God has allowed the churches of America, many right now, to sit desolate and empty. The voice of the bridegroom and the bride is gone. That's the church and Christ. There is no laughter. There is no joy. Doors are closed. At that time, says the Lord, they shall bring out the bones of the kings of Judah and the bones of its princes and the bones of the priests and the bones of the prophets and the bones of the inhabitants of Jerusalem out of their graves. They shall spread them before the sun and the moon and all the hosts of heaven which they have loved. See, they have worshipped the sun, moon, and the stars, the zodiac, in which they have served and after which they have walked, which they have sought and which they have worshipped. They shall not be gathered nor buried. They shall be like refuse on the face of the earth. Then death shall be chosen rather than life by all the residue of those who remain of this evil family. He's calling his people Israel an evil family, who remain in all the places where I have driven them, says the Lord of hosts. He's saying all of these wicked kings and all of these leaders who have gone before, I'm going to allow, this was an ancient practice, I'm going to allow their bones to be brought out of the mausoleums, and they're going to be scattered. They're going to be visible for all to see. Moreover, you shall say to them, thus says the Lord, will they fall and not rise? Will one turn away and not return? Why has this people slidden back, Jerusalem, in a perpetual backsliding? They hold fast to deceit. They refuse to return. I listened and heard, but they do not speak aright. Listen to this statement. I listened and I heard, but they do not speak aright. Those of you who are walking with the Lord right now, you're listening. You're listening to what relatives are saying. You're listening to what people are saying in the news. You're listening to what people that you know in the workplace are saying, and they're copying things like parrots, and they're saying things that are upside down and backwards that make no sense, and you have discernment. You're listening. If you're walking with the Lord, you're listening and you hear it, but you say, this doesn't make sense. This is not right, what they are saying. They do not speak aright. No man repented of his wickedness. This is again, I'm not speaking. You remember Elijah said, Lord, I'm the only one left. And Lord corrected him and said, I have 7,000 in Israel who have not bowed the knee. So when I say the church today, I'm not talking about all. God has reserved a remnant for himself who love him with all of their heart, soul, mind, and strength. But he looks at the large picture of what is called the church in America. And he says, no one repented of his wickedness, saying, what have I done? How many people do you find today who are sensitive to the Holy Spirit of God and who can be cut to the heart when they realize that they have done something that has offended God, and they fall before him on their knees and they say, oh Lord, what have I done? I repent. Help me. Change me, Lord. Everyone turned to his own course. His own dictates, his own decisions, his own will, his own way, as the horse rushes into the battle. In other words, everybody's running after their own will just as hard and fast as the horse that runs into battle. Even the stork in the heavens, listen to this, even the stork in the heavens knows her appointed times, and the turtle dove, the swift and the swallow, observe the time of their coming, but my people do not know the judgment of the Lord. God's people do not want to know the judgment of the Lord. They don't like the word judgment. They think it's harsh to say such a thing, and they live in their own peril, in the danger of their own peril, because they say, I don't want to hear such words. I don't want to hear a word of judgment. Charles Spurgeon, the great preacher from years ago, he preached a sermon on this passage called Migratory Birds. And it's interesting, he divided this into four things. He said the migratory birds know when to come and go. They have an instinct and they know when to come and go. The people of God who hear his voice know when to come and go, when to follow him in one direction or another direction. The migratory birds know where to go by what has been put within them. And the people of God know where to go in a time of calamity by what God has put within them. The migratory birds know the way to get there, the way to go by what has been put within them. And you will only know the way to go in these days in which we're living if it has been put within you by the Spirit of God. The migratory birds show their wisdom by actually going to the place that it has been put within them to go to. For us, it is the secret place of the Most High, under the shadow of the Almighty, a place where we dwell with God and we know God. How can you say we are wise and the law of the Lord is with us? Look, the false pen of the scribe certainly works falsehood. The wise men are ashamed, they're dismayed and taken. Behold, they have rejected the word of the Lord, so what wisdom do they have? When he speaks of the false pen of the scribe, what he is speaking of is that everyone who teaches the word of God does not necessarily teach a true word. There is a deceptive teaching of the word of God. Therefore, I will give their wives to others and their fields to those who will inherit them. Because from the least even to the greatest, everyone is given to covetousness. From the prophet even to the priest, everyone deals falsely. For they have healed the hurt of the daughter of my people slightly, saying, peace, peace, when there is no peace. I wonder how many prophets in America have prophesied in the last month, peace, peace, when in reality there is no peace. I know that there, the internet and YouTube is full of people who are prophesying about what's going to happen next. And many of them have already prophesied that coronavirus would be over before now. Some of them even gave a date as to when it would have ended. People are prophesying one thing and prophesying another thing. And sometimes we glean something from these people on YouTube or on the internet, and we recognize it as the voice of the Lord. But most of the time I'm sitting there going, well, I hear what you're saying, and then I hear what this one's saying, and then I hear what this one is saying, and none of them line up together with the Word of God. You'd better know the Word of God for yourself. You better know how to sit with the Lord and how to find what He wants you to know, that you might know, like the migratory birds, the way to go, the place to go, the time to go, and how to get there. Amen. They have healed the hurt of my daughter of my people slightly. In other words, they tried to help them a little bit, but it was not, what they were saying was false. And they gave them false comfort and false hope in a time where that was not what was called for. Were they ashamed when they had committed abomination? No, they were not at all ashamed. And this is today, nor did they know how to blush. I preached this years ago, and it's still true. When's the last time you saw someone blush? Therefore, they shall fall among those who fall. In the time of their punishment, they shall be cast down, says the Lord. I will surely consume them, says the Lord. No grapes shall be on the vine, nor figs on the fig tree, and the leaves shall fade, and the things I have given them shall pass away from them. I need to move quickly. Why do we sit still? Assemble yourselves and let us enter the fortified cities. Let us be silent there. For the Lord our God has put us to silence and given us water of gall to drink, because we have sinned against the Lord. We looked for peace, but no good came, and for a time of health, but there was trouble. The snorting of his horses was heard from Dan. The whole land trembled at the sound of the neighing of his strong ones, for they have come and devoured the land and all that is in it, the city and those who dwell in it. For behold, I will send serpents among you, vipers which cannot be charmed, and they shall bite you, says the Lord. To the church in the new covenant, we understand what serpents and vipers are. And the Lord says, you walk in disobedience to me. You will not submit your heart and surrender to me. You open the door yourself. I will send, you have removed my hand of protection, and I will send demonic spirits. I will send those things that will come in, will set up camp in your midst, that will carry you even further away from me, will bite you and harm you than where you would have been. I would comfort myself in sorrow. My heart is faint in me. Listen, the voice, the cry of the daughter of my people from a far country. Is not the Lord in Zion? Is not her king in her? Why have they provoked me to anger with their carved images, with foreign idols? The harvest is past, the summer is ended, and we are not saved. For the hurt of the daughter of my people, I am hurt. I am mourning. Astonishment has taken hold of me. This is us. Astonishment has taken hold of me. I am amazed at what I am seeing. I am even more amazed at the blindness of so many church leaders, so many prophets and pastors, so many people who, even in a time of calamity, will not give forth the true word of God, will not speak the gospel, but will continue to tell stories that make people feel good, who will say peace, peace, when there is no peace. Is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no physician there? Why then is there no recovery for the health of the daughter of my people? Beloved, without Christ, the great physician, there would be no healing for God's people. Oh, that my head were waters. I love this because I'm not claiming this anymore. I'm not saying it. I'm saying in the past, I have truly been an escapist at times. When things are bad, I really want to go to the beach. When things are bad, I really want to have a little place somewhere that I can hide. When things are bad, I just want to get away and just be me and Maggie and the Lord, you know? I take comfort in the fact that Jeremiah was the same way. He wanted a hotel. Listen, he wanted a hotel in the desert. Look at this. Oh, that my head were waters and my eyes a fountain of tears, that I might weep day and night for the slain of the daughter of my people. Oh, that I had in the wilderness a lodging place for travelers, that I might leave my people and go from them, for they are all adulterers, an assembly of treacherous men. Now, I don't feel that way about you. We're going to stop there. So Jeremiah has outlined God's opinion of a time exactly like our day, a time for the church. And this may surprise you that I will bring this up, but here is the heart issue from Genesis to Revelation. And here is the heart issue in the midst of Jeremiah's time. Here is the heart issue in the middle of our time, which we see right now coming, society coming unglued with lawlessness as a result of it. And this is the heart issue of submission to that word that we all do not like apart from Christ. In our own strength and in our own flesh nature, we hate this word. It is part of the fall from the Garden of Eden, that we are in the image of Adam and Eve, and that we do not like this reality, and that is submission to authority. Submission to authority. And I want this morning to take just a brief few moments. My desire is that whenever I teach or preach on this, I know that it hits most Christians. But what I want to do is hopefully make you sensitive. For when you understand this principle in the Word of God, then you're sensitive to it. Everywhere that you go, you see it in other people. Not that you see it in a judgmental way, but your heart is grieved because you recognize why their life is falling apart. You recognize why they're not walking with God. You recognize why there's calamity and trouble in their life. You recognize why there's calamity and trouble in the land. Everything revolves around this issue. From the Garden of Eden, man chose. God held Adam accountable as the head of the human race. And Adam chose. We make light of Adam's sin. We make light of Adam's sin. In our hearts, we just really sometimes don't understand until we dig in the Word of God. We look and, well, you know, he just ate a piece of fruit. And after all, didn't God set him up? And at the heart of the issue is man's inclination to choose his own will rather than the will of God. God was going to give them everything that heaven could give. He would have instructed them in right and wrong. He would have taught them the knowledge of the tree of good and evil. Everything would have been done by God himself as they submitted and surrendered and allowed him to be their teacher and their instructor. But what they did was nothing short of high treason against Almighty God. It was man choosing his own will, his own way, and choosing to buck the authority of heaven, of the throne of God. We all are born with the tendency. We all are born with this blackness in our heart. We do not like submission. The flesh, the heart, despises it. We can't stand the thought of giving our control over to another. And this is the heart issue of pride. Pride is married into this because pride says, I can do it, I will do it, I want to do it, I have the right to do it, I'm self-sufficient, I'm the master of my own fate, I can create my own destiny, I can make my own choices, I'm smart enough, good enough, strong enough, I can do it all on my own, thank you. And God says, no, you can't. And until we learn what it means to be like the Apostle Paul, who said, I am a bondservant. A bondservant was one who had been a slave and had been given the option of his freedom. But he chose, rather than to choose freedom, he said, I love my master so much that he went over to a door and they put his earlobe against the door and they drove a nail through it into the doorpost in order to pierce his ear as a sign that he was now a bondservant of Jesus Christ, or a bondservant of his master. And for Paul, he said, I'm a bondservant. He's given me freedom and liberty, but I want to be his slave. I want to be his servant all the days of my life. We don't like authority. We don't like to be told what to do. We love the idea of things flowing from the throne of God. We like the idea of the throne of God being a great fountain for us, from which come blessings, and they do, blessings in the natural and blessings that are spiritual. We like it when God gives us some light, some revelation as we read and as we study the Word of God. We like it that we can go to God for healing. It is a gift that flows from the throne of God, and miraculous gifts of the Holy Spirit flow from the throne of God. Mercy, we all want His mercy, don't we? Mercy flows from the throne of God. Grace, protection, comfort, and even power to live. But it's for those who choose to fall on their knees and say, Lord, you are everything. Be my master. He said, you know, in the earth, people love to lord their authority over others, but among you, it shall not be so. For he who would be great must be servant of all. There is authority everywhere that you turn, because authority flows from the throne of God. All authority. Because without God's creation, his creative power, and his sustaining of all things, and his directing of all things, there would be no authority, and there would be nothing taking place. All authority originates from the throne of God. Some of it gets usurped, polluted, corrupted. Satan usurped authority. It still came from the throne of God. It's still allowed by God today until time has run its course and God finalizes everything concerning Satan. But God has him on a leash. It's still God's authority, even when it gets corrupted by man. You say, what about the police? What about the governments? What? Yes, corrupt authorities all over the place. But he says, obey the authorities because they are from God. Now, I don't have to teach you as believers, the Word of God does not say that you're to obey authority when it crosses God's authority, when it tells you to do something against God's authority. But you still do not disobey with a rebellious heart. Do you understand? You can refuse to do something and still not be rebellious. It can be that it is a very difficult thing. And you say, I refuse, but I refuse with respect because you're an authority. But you follow the law of God above all other laws. All authority flows from the throne of God. There's, listen, you who are under 20, under 19 or 18 years of age, there's authority in the family. Yes, even if that authority is not perfect and you don't like the way it is dished out to you, there's authority in the family. There's authority in the church. These are delegated authorities from God. There's authority in your workplace. Your job is to do the best for your boss in order to make him look good. There's authority in the police, even though there's corruption among the police. There's authority in the police. But we have something in us that when the policeman pulls us over, something rises up inside of us and we really want to set him straight. That is rebellion. We are to submit to the authorities as unto the Lord. There's the authority, the direct authority of God and his word. And so we come before him, and when we are sensitive to God, we are sensitive to authority. We understand when there's a streak of rebelliousness in us and we refuse. You know, we had a praise and worship leader one time years ago. Most of you wouldn't even know him. But we had a praise and worship leader years ago one time that said, you know, when people tell me to do something, I just really don't want to do it then. I thought, oh, no, we've got problems. Because we were encouraging. We weren't demanding. The Word of God says, lift your hands to the Lord. The Word of God says, shout to the Lord with a voice of triumph. And so we were encouraging the congregation to do that. And she stood up in the midst of that and said, well, you know, when you tell people to do something, they don't want to do it. I know when people tell me not to do so, or to do something. I don't want to do it. Beloved, that is being insensitive to authority, and it is rebelliousness. We are to be sensitive to the authorities around us, and above all, the authority of God Almighty. All authority flows from his throne. Oh, how our flesh despises being controlled. I need to do this quickly. You become a Christian and you bring yourself under the authority of God by being in agreement. It's not in a perfect arrangement. It is an agreement with God. You recognize his authority. This is part and parcel of what salvation is. You submit to God. He saves you because he is the authority of the universe. But then comes the walk with God. The walk with God is when every day of your life, see, once you submit to God's authority, your flesh kicks in and says, I don't want to do that. And so the flesh wars against the spirit inside of you. And every day it's then a choice. I will submit my flesh. I will submit to the authority of God because I love him. Not because I'm just demanded, but because I love him. Because I'm a bondservant of the Lord. In the end times, I see that this is magnified. That's why the word of God says that in the last days, lawlessness will abound. You know, I see parents who tell their children to be rebellious in certain situations, not even realizing what they are instilling within them. I'm telling you, young parents here today, I'm not chastising. I'm not saying I've seen you do this. I'm saying be sensitive to this. Do not instill rebellion. Do not encourage it or disrespect for authority in your children because it's a road to destruction. They rescue their children from authority. I realize there are times you have to perhaps go against a school teacher or something, but you still must respect authority and you must explain that to your children, and you can't always rescue them from authority that's not perfect, or they will become 25 years old and think they must be rescued from every authority that's not perfect. They speak disrespectfully of authority in front of other, the adults speak disrespectfully of authorities in front of their children, and then that instills it in the children. I have heard parents who giggle when their children are rebellious and do terrible things, and they say, oh, aren't they cute? Be sensitive to authority and God's authority and instill that. Who does your life belong to? Does it belong to you or does it belong to the Lord? These are serious things. These are things that must be settled in your heart if you're going to walk with God in these days. Now, Jeremiah, he heard God. And he carried this burden that he delivered by speaking the words to the people. But Jeremiah was limited. He was limited in his ability to respond in the way that you and I can respond today. And I will explain what I mean. I'm going to begin by taking us back to a year ago, almost a year. We still need revival. This is what God is putting in my heart. We are still in need of revival. We are still in need of the fire of God. I think that during this shutdown, it's been easy to just sit back. And it's been like this giant parentheses in time. Going with the will of God and things were going a certain direction, then boom, shut down. Sit on the couch, watch TV. It's time to pick up where we left off. I know many of you had made what, I don't know if this is the right word, but strides forward with the Lord. I know that God was touching some of your hearts and that you were unburdening yourself before his throne and you were giving things to him and you're saying, Lord, I want to go deeper. I know that things need to change in my life. And I know some of you, because I know comments that you made to me. I know some of you, there was a hunger and a thirst beginning to develop. You know, I had said that if you're not hungry or thirsty for God or you don't have desire, then begin by praying, Lord, I don't even have desire. Please give me desire. And then boom, the big parenthesis. It's time to pick up where we left off. We still need revival. We still need the fire of God. We still need everything that God has for us. We still need the gifts of His Spirit in order to minister and to bring forth life in a time of darkness and to bring forth light. We are to be a generation that shows forth the majesty, the glory, the power of God. We are redeemed believers of the new covenant. Jeremiah was part of the old covenant. We are part of the new covenant after Calvary, after Pentecost. Our repentance comes with limitations removed. What do I mean by that? I was thinking on this whole thing. Jeremiah had a limitation. He was speaking, listen closely before we come to the end of this morning. Jeremiah was speaking to an Old Testament nation of people who believed in God, but everything about repentance and revival with them just simply meant come back to the law of God. Come back to the law of God. And it's a hard thing because the law is a hard taskmaster. Amen. We have the result of what the law was for. It was to point us to Christ, show us our great need for Him. Yes. Jeremiah was preaching to a people who did not have the promise of the fullness of the indwelling Holy Spirit personally for each one of them. All they could do was come and repent and try to keep the law again. And it's amazing because even under those conditions, there were times of revival when they turned to the Lord with all of their heart and they loved Him and they served Him and God moved on their behalf. But far beyond that, look at Pentecost. When God came, when He sent His Spirit upon the early church, they began to move in power and they could hear the voice of God. They didn't have to have one prophet telling a whole nation. Now He said, you can all prophesy. You may all be prophets because the Spirit of God is coming to dwell inside of you. And you may all walk in power. You may all walk in the will of God, discerning the will of God. But it begins with submission. What do you think they were doing in the upper room for that 120 people? All of those days they were waiting on the Holy Spirit to come. They were falling into place. They were getting into one accord with each other and the will of God. They were submitting. Beloved, do you understand from Genesis all the way to Revelation, this is the heart of the issue? Will you submit to authority? Will you submit to the will of God for your life? Will you submit your heart to Him in love? Will you yield to His will for you? Will you stop seeing authority as a bad thing that you resist? And will you grab hold of the great, glorious, wonderful thing that comes when we submit our hearts to God fully? Do you understand that even the prodigal son is about this? I know it's about the love of the Father. That's how we always hear it. It's the love of the Father. He's standing on the hill. He's waiting on His son who has erred. And He returns and He's restored. What a beautiful picture of what God has for us when we stray. But beloved, why did He stray in the first place? Why did He leave the Father's house? Do you think in His heart it was just a matter of, I want to go sin? Do you think that was all it was? I want to go sin. I just want to go sin. No, I want to get out from under Father's house. I don't want to be under His authority. I want to do my own will. And every time you leave the will of God, every time you wander from what God has for you amongst the church, His people, and His will being revealed to you in your own personal life, you come out from under the authority of God. And you're doing the same thing as the prodigal son. It's all about submission and authority. He left the Father's house because He wanted to come out from under Father's authority. He wanted to come out of the Father's house where there was light and there was life. And He wanted to go somewhere where He could do His own thing. Think about it. You can come to church every Sunday and you can be left Father's house in your heart. You can be walking in rebellion against the Lord. Jeremiah did not have Pentecost. Jeremiah did not have prayer language. He did not have the gift of praying in the Spirit. Jeremiah did not have that empowerment that the disciples had. Unless God just came upon him for a moment. The Old Testament prophets, God would come upon them. Sometimes they would do miraculous things. He would come upon them, and then they would speak what God is saying. New Testament believers, he comes upon you. He fills you. He comes to reside. And you all may prophesy, and you all may do the will of the Lord. You all may walk in the power of the Lord, depending upon your faith. Jeremiah didn't have the revelation that you have of the great, wonderful mystery of Christ being revealed. Paul called it the mystery that was hidden for ages past. And now it's revealed. Christ in you. Christ in you. Say Christ in me. Christ in me. Jeremiah didn't have that. You have so much more available to you. He did not have the empowerment or the gifts. He had grief. He had grief for the people of God. But he did not have the love that was poured out on Calvary. The agape love that is part of the Christian life. Jeremiah did not have what you have. And he still needed to repent himself. He needed revival himself. We still need revival. We still need revival. So this morning I'm going to close by asking you, when you look around, think about what we read in Jeremiah. Will you stop listening to what the world says? And we say, God, what are you saying about this generation? He'll show you. And will you let the Holy Spirit deal with that rebelliousness? I'm saying that to all of us. I'm not pointing the finger at anyone. I'm saying it is human nature, but human nature stands in opposition against the Spirit of God. So we all have this nature within us. Will you submit yourself fully to the will of the Lord? Will you stop battling the authorities that are around you? Because listen closely, if a man or a woman, boy or girl, cannot submit to the authorities around them, then they cannot truly submit to the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
And will you realize what God has for you? Will you begin to cry out? Say, Lord, I believe, like the centurion. I believe, but help my unbelief. Lord, I want to, but my flesh doesn't. Help me. Lord, I don't have the desire I should have. Would you stir it within me again? I'm not saying that if you pray that this afternoon, that he's going to do it this afternoon. He wants to know you mean business. You must set your hand to the plow and not look back. You must say, this is worth everything to me. This is worth everything to me, is that I walk with God. And I want to be a light to my family and to my generation. And if you're the only one in this congregation, that you might say, I'm going to be that one that has the power of the Holy Spirit operating in my life, that walks in fullness and in victory, I'm going to stop being a victim. And I'm going to start being a victorious Christian. I'm going to know how to do battle when Satan comes against me with temptation. And I'm going to overcome in my life. These things are what God has for you. It's time that we put our hand to the plow. And it's time that we went back to the place of repentance. And we learn to walk in it, learn to live it, learn to walk in fullness. Amen?
Amen.
We're going to, if you would, you know, just remain seated. We're going to close in prayer. Father, would you please take this word and bury it in good soil everywhere that you find it? Do not let Satan come and steal it this afternoon. Stir our hearts, Lord, that we would rise up Lord, my own flesh fights against this. My own flesh says you're getting older. Slow down, take it easy, because your body doesn't want to cooperate and you're tired and all of these things. Lord, help me to overcome. Help these to overcome. God, more than anything in these latter days, make us praying men and women. I confess I fail so often. Satan fights me so hard on this issue, this front. But help me to get the victory, Lord. Fill us. Fill this church with your Spirit. Give us a corporate vision, Lord, of you glorified in our midst, pouring out life-changing power, Lord, for those whose lives are devastated around us. Lord, we're tired of praying for people and just seeing them go on and be destroyed. Yes. Help us to see people changed, transformed, walking in the power of the fullness of the Spirit of God. Comfort those today who are afraid. Help us to conquer that fear and to want what you have for us, Lord. Submitting to you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Pastor?
Yes.
The Lord gave me something to share.